gifted.
We're smart, and my...
He told me enough.
No, I...
Part of me wanted to have hope, and another part of me tried to warn me about this. Man. But, regardless, as you can tell now, hey everyone, it's Don G. Corleone here, and I'm here with a brand new rant. And this rant is going to be for a new release that came out last weekend. And it's for a... fourth entry of a franchise whose sequel came out 4 years ago, months before the pandemic. And it's for the first blockbuster to star Will Smith in 2 years. And of course, it's going to be for none other than the fourth entry in the Bad Boys franchise, Bad Boys Ride or Die. Directed by the directors of For Life Again, what were their names? Adil and Bilal, again. Yeah. Returning from Bad Boys for Life. So what's the plus? Well, as you all know by the trailers, like, when their former captain is implicated in corruption for some weird plot device reason, even though apparently his death was supposed to come off as a random shock. Yeah, this is a dead guy now framed. The Miami police officers have to work to clear his name. Yeah, that's stupid because this guy died in the third one. It's already a stupid idea. Instead of somebody who they know who's alive, let's incriminate somebody who died in the last movie. So the crime would be stupid as hell to pull off. Well, that was me was, well, after Bad Boys for Life's good opening weekend, Sony decided to do a fourth entry, predictable, with and Chris Bremner would return. Then in April 2022, the fourth film, because the slap happened at the Oscars, the film was rumored to be put on hold, but then the later month, it apparently was still in development after all. So the year after the slap, February 2023, Smith confirmed he and Lawrence would reprise their roles, and the returning directors from For Life would be coming back to direct this. And Questlove reported that Smith apparently had to drop out of a planned surprise appearance at the Grammy Awards because pre-production for the fourth film was starting that week. Then in March 2023, Vanessa Hudgens, who's starring Bad Boys for Life, would be returning for this one. Eric Dane was also cast as the villain. More on that in a bit. And Paul Newman's Alexander Ludwig reprisal roles. Lone Gruffer to join the cast and... Rhea Seehorn joined the cast, so... And then originally the working title was Ride or Die. And that was apparently the permanent title, and it was confirmed in early 2024. So, after this movie was shot and officially marketed, Ride or Die premiered at the Coca-Cola Arena in Dubai on May 22nd, 2024, and was released to the public last weekend on June 6th, 2024. By Sony, like it's been for the whole other movies, and received mixed to positive reviews from critics, and at the box office worldwide, it grossed over $104 million worldwide. So there you go, guys. A good summer opening weekend, box office new reporters. You're finally happy now? Now you finally have something you don't have to call a flop. There you go. Finally happy you got your weekends? One weekend for one, so it's like... almost every movie was a box office bomb in May. Apparently, everyone was already calling it a bad summer for movies. Like, the summer hadn't even freaking started yet. They're already calling it that. How about wait for the summer to play out first before you start calling it a lousy summer for films? But the thing is, though, there were better movies released last month that deserve to have more of an opening weekend than this. Because as for my reaction, a part of me tried to have hope for this. Like, when I heard this was announced, I was like, I liked Bad Boys for Life. If you didn't like it, each their own. I still enjoyed it. But I was wondering, do we really need a fourth one? For Life was perfect to end it on. It was a nice spot to leave it alone. I really don't think we need this, but because it made money, and we know Holly Weird, another movie is going to happen, regardless if we wanted it or not. But I still try to have hope for this. Like, maybe this is a franchise that can still be good, because if I did enjoy Bad Boys for Life, maybe there's still a bit of life in this franchise. Even if I was like, if it was really necessary. Like, but Bad Boys for Life's end, like, here's the thing, though. Alright. Here's the thing. With the way this movie ended, like, Mike and Marcus, they're gonna now run their own police team. They're not retired. They don't retire. They choose not to retire regardless. They're gonna now run their own little squad. Marcus is now a grandfather. Mike's even gonna help his son redeem himself during his jail sentence. And even Mike's gonna help Marcus take care of his grandson just by that last shot of them. That was the perfect ending right there in my eyes. There was no sequel setups, okay? I don't care what people say, but the scene where he visits his son, that wasn't a sequel setup in my eyes. It wasn't some sappy bullshit where one of them dies. It wasn't a generic retire ending, okay? This was a nice spot to leave it alone. Yep, and like... But, of course, the slap happened, so Will wasn't going to have much money makers for a while. So you could tell this was just made for the money and just give Will a box office success because his career was in a bad shape right now after the whole slap happened and after he still won't leave Jada and just needs something on his career, just needs a money maker this way because no one's really going to hire him except for these people. But here's the thing, though. When I saw the trailers, the plot concept was a stupid idea because apparently from the trailers, it seemed like Howard was full-on aware of his death and is now suddenly framed for a crime gang's activities. So these criminals choose to frame a guy who's dead despite the fact that they'd probably get figured out quick anyway since this is a dead guy they're framing all of a sudden. Like, we saw Captain Howard dead in For Life. Mike's son sniped him when he announced he was thinking of retiring. And then you got the captains down. And then you had the funeral right there. His body was buried. He's dead. I saw him die in the movie. We all saw him die. Like, and now the bad boys just become fugitives. Like, yeah. Not only is this was just also just being made because Will Smith had nothing, neither did Martin Lawrence. Exception of Bad Boys for Life, what other stuff did he do around the 2010s? Like, with the exception, from the 2000s, there was Bad Boys 2, but he also did shitty movies like the Big Mama's House films, which I'm not a fan of. And somehow that Big Mama's House somehow gets sequels, but Blue Streak didn't. Blue Streak should have got a trilogy, not Big Mama's House. I think Big Mama's House is... I'm not a fan of Big Mama's House. So the sequels are worse. National Security with Steve Zahn was crap. College Road Trip, that Disney movie he did with Raven, was crap. The animated film Open Season was also crap. This guy did a lot of crappy career choices in the 2000s. And Bad Boys was pretty much the only moneymaker he has at this rate. So yeah. They'll make more of these movies because this is all they have. But I saw this film anyway, and, well, guess what? The other half that tried to warn me was right. This film fucking sucked. I thought this movie was dog shit, it was a waste of time, and I can tell they're just now going to Fast and Furious territory with this movie, and this movie hardly felt like Bad Boys. and people want to bitch about Bad Boys for Life, and somehow people actually think this movie was better than Bad. Some people even apparently must think this is better than Bad Boys 2 and Bad Boys for Life combined. Like, what part of this felt like Bad Boys? Explain it to me, okay? Explain how this felt like a Bad Boys movie. And if much as people want to hate Bad Boys for Life, try watching this and then go claim if this is any better. People want to shit on this movie. I'd watch this movie any day over this. Because even if this was not done by Michael Bay, this actually at least still felt like a Bad Boys movie, or tried to feel like a Bad Boys movie. This did not. This was just Will and Martin running out of ideas, trying whatever shtick they can think of, going into a jungle, Martin Lawrence going on a sugar rush crazy after a Widowmaker heart attack, acting like a fucking idiot. Yeah, literally just them becoming fugitives and having a bunch of Fast and Furious, like, action moments at this rate. Like, here, like, now, like, yeah. Yeah, like, but yeah, like, in these three movies, like, this whole trilogy, when I watched this, I watched these three movies because Will and Martin have the perfect chemistry in these films, and they're what carried these films. They always looked like they were having a blast or enthusiasm and energy in these movies, or what I enjoy about these movies. And their story arcs in these movies, like, yeah. The story arcs in these movies were great. First one, you had, like, Martin Lawrence's character having to pretend to be Will Smith's character to protect a witness of a crime. Then, of course, you had Bad Boys 2, Will and Martin. They both have to pretty much stop this drug raid that's going on in Miami. And it goes into Grindhouse territory. Hell, like, this one, they have to, like, stop this old relative of Will Smith's character, and finds out that this, and even try to redeem, to get his son to go to the good side, even. Like, yeah, and while kind of contemplating or retiring or not retiring, especially after Martin Lawrence now has a grandson. This is a dead guy, our dead captain being framed, and then becoming fugitives. How is that Bad Boys? I don't watch Bad Boys for that. Their character arcs in this, they just come out of nowhere in this movie. They're too bizarre. And it just holds everything I like about this franchise back. Yeah, like, and like the rest of the characters aren't even that great either. Like, Mike Laurie's son is back in this movie. He has very little charisma. He has nothing to do. Yeah, like, honestly, I didn't mind him in Bad Boys for Life, but this one, he's fucking useless to have in the movie. Yeah, Vanessa Hudgens and Alexander Ludwig, they're back as Killing Dorm, and their roles reduced, so they're also useless. They get nothing to do except be low-level comic relief. They were fine in Bad Boys for Life as well. I didn't over-hate them. I didn't like them at first, but I grew to kind of like them as they got a little bit more likable as For Life progressed, at least. They got more tolerable as that movie progressed when Mike and Marcus were training them. Yeah, right there. And they started to get along with Mike a little more as that film progressed. Here they get nothing. And Bad Boys for Life, even Bad Boys for Life, they actually did shit. They're just trying to be as funny as Will and Martin, and they come off as just unfunny. Lone Gruffer, reassuring, they're generic as hell. And now, like, how does this movie even start? Well, now, it did start off kind of entertaining, but it goes downhill as it progresses. Once again, like the other movies, opens in Miami. Mike and Marcus are speeding on the streets, like the first film, the third film started off. And this time, like, they're on their way to another event. Like, the third one, they were on their way to see Marcus's grandson being born. So, that was a nice way to start off life. Here, they're driving off to Mike's wedding, and Marcus is about to vomit because of how Mike is driving, complains about being nauseous, and wants a ginger ale. So Mike gives him a few stops and gives him a few seconds to get a ginger ale. But Marcus just gets the ginger ale. But then, oh, wait. Hey, Skittles. Yeah, I'm going to open the bag and not pay for them and eat them. Blah, blah. Ooh, hey, clerk, can I get this hot dog, please? Yeah, so, yeah. Yeah, literally, guys. I'm not kidding. Like, when he gets the Skittles, he does, before he even walks over the counter, he literally opens the bag and pours some of them in his mouth. Doesn't even pay for them. Like, I thought Marcus was supposed to be the more smarter of the two with laws, and supposed to be a cop who's is somehow apparently willing to shoplift Skittles and not get in trouble for it. Then a gunman tries to rob the place. Then, of course, because Mike found out Marcus took a while, he goes in there and literally chastises Marcus for not just for getting more things and not just a ginger ale. And then, of course, Marcus moves to gunman and Mike, and the gunman gets shot in the leg by Mike. Like, oh my god. Here's the thing, though. Like, yeah, like, sometimes they use stupid shit and when they get in stores, like, bad boy. And here's the thing. Okay, when you had this movie, when they get that camera, Mike and Marcus went to a TV store, and they accidentally broadcasted on broadcast a sex tape all over the TVs, and then of course they go into the TV room to kind of complain, like kind of this little confession chat, and then they realize their whole inappropriate shack got broadcasted all over the TVs. Yeah, like. That's the thing, though. That was by accident, and at least they clarified they needed to check the footage for police business. And then when they the thing is, they didn't know their confession was being recorded. And when they found out, they immediately left. And I think they even apologized for it. The thing is, they broadcasted the sex tape all over their TVs and their conversation by accident. Okay, they weren't committing any crimes. They were trying to detect that footage for police business. Here, Marcus literally steals Skittles without paying for them because it goes on a junk food binge thing throughout the whole movie. But anyway, though, they get to Mike's wedding, and he's married his physical therapist, who's named Christine, just played by Melanie Libbird. Then Marcus's wife Teresa joins them, their daughter Megan, Reggie, even. Yeah, Reggie's still in this film again. And, like, and of course, they get Katharina Sikade, her boyfriend, Adam Lockwood, and of course they also have the agents, like, from the Bowers for Life, Kelly Dorn, and of course the late Captain Howard's daughter, because he died in the last movie, and Marshall Judy is played by Rhea Seehorn, and her daughter. Then in the middle of festivities, Marcus then suffers a near-fatal heart attack and he collapses. Marcus finds himself on a beach while people are trying to revive him. And he sees Howard by the tree. And he sees Marcus and tells him, like, it's not your time. You got to go back. So Marcus is in the hospital. And apparently now has a newfound appreciation of life. And some sense of confidence over his mortality. And literally, the first thing he does is takes out all his tubes carelessly. And then goes, yeah, I'm out of here. And he just walks up. You know, I'm surprised Mariah Carey's song from Free Guy didn't randomly start playing, like, sweet, sweet fantasy, baby. When he was walking, I'm surprised he didn't start playing that when he started to walk up there. Like, yeah, clearly, yeah, he almost walks like Ryan Reynolds, and like Ryan Reynolds gets up at the start of Free Guy, and that song starts playing. Almost walked like him. Like, there, I'm surprised the song didn't start playing there. So, yeah, he goes up to the roof of his gown. He literally exposes the world his dick off screen. We don't see his dick, thank God. But then, of course, when he returned back and, like, Mike tells him to get off the roof right there. And so then, of course, we get a close-up shot of the wind blowing up and exposing Marcus's bare ass. Yeah, when I watch Bad Boys, that's totally what I want to see. I totally want to see shots of Marcus's bare ass whenever I watch these movies. That's what I want to see in a Bad Boys movie. But whatever, he goes back home. Everybody celebrates his return, his family, Mike. And Marcus tries to look for all the junk food in his house because now he's going on a junk food binge. But Teresa got rid of all of it. And first he thinks, like, yeah, and then of course, and you get the bit in the trailer now where it looks like Reggie was jobless and just sitting on the couch. And Mark's like, you need to get a job. And like, but of course, like, and I was like, when I saw this in the trailer, like, I thought Reggie was in the army. Why is he now a slob? All of a sudden, Bowies for Life had shown he was in the army. How is this guy suddenly a slob now? Like, yeah, thankfully he's not a slob here, and he clarifies he's still in the army, and it's just kind of taking a little bit of a breather or a bit of a break from the army for a while to be with his, like, son. So, yeah, If he was a slacker, that just would have pissed me off more. So yeah, most of this movie you already get Marcus being an idiot, clearly, then getting a heart attack, then acting like a dumbass, and trying to go for a bunch of junk food after surviving a near deadly heart attack. They just get too many repetitive jokes here. They're not as funny as that people want you to think they are. Yeah, it's like, there's some, like, some of the drama is not even played out well. Even this movie did the drama way better. And I don't really care about any of the characters here. And the script was even weaker as hell. Like the previous film, like, it tried to tell more personal story about, like, their, about them, and their about them contemplating retirement here. It didn't over-preach it. It didn't over-preach it like Clerks 3 did. Hell, like, this was a better Clerks 3 than Clerks 3 itself. Yeah, like, they were pretty successful, but when this film tries it, it just falls flat in its face because they got lazy. Yeah, like, seriously. Like, the main character story arcs here, they're just dumb. The villain's motivation is basically money, so they try to frame a dead guy for it, and it's stupid as hell because they would immediately figure out that the guy would not be committing crimes while dead, and so they'd get exposed anyway. So literally everything just felt predictable, and this movie even makes baffling decisions about where the main characters, they never explore things in, like, interesting ways. Like, Mike has a panic attack at one point in the movie. They barely explain that at all. Like, that could have been a good plot point for the film. They chose not to do it. They used to reference something else later. There's many side characters that are not as interesting here. So, like, yeah, Hudgens and... No, like, Dorn and Kelly trying to be Smith and Lawrence and failing at it. Like, those... Like, Smith and Lawrence are way better in the first three movies than any of these two are trying to be here now. And the supporting cast is just... In the back half, they're overwhelming. And yeah, like, once again, this did not feel like... What part of this was Bad Boys? What part of this spelt Bad Boys? Okay? Nothing. This was not a Bad Boys movie. Alright? It just wasn't. You know, and the villains in this movie, like, Eric's character, I think it's Eric, like, they are boring as shit, and they suck ass. They are generic, they feel like villains in a Fast and Furious movie, their dialogue is informal, given the circumstances, and like a portion of the villains, they feel fucking useless, they're fucking stupid with their plan. Like, here's the thing, when you have villains in these movies, this movie, you had Fouchette. Or Fouché, or I can't pronounce his name, but this guy was a legitimate threat. Like, he was the reason, like he was constantly trying to murder Taleone. Taleone fell in danger here, and Marcus and Mike had to do anything they can, even make a few lies to keep her safe from his threats right here. And, you know, and like, and also this guy was trying to endanger Mike and Marcus's careers. Yeah, it's like, this movie, you had Johnny Tapia, who is both intimidating and goofy and comical right here. He had such funny lines here. Like when he saw the picture, he had his daughter cover her ears and cursed at the guy who made it and threatened him right there. And you had like when he puts drugs in dead bodies and threatens one guy into joining him with the barrel of the body parts. Hell, this movie had a better villain called Isabella. Yeah, like, yeah. All three of these people are better than any of these jackasses. Their plans were not laughable. Their plans actually seem like villain plans. And they don't try to frame people who are dead. And they seem smarter than these people. And when it comes to the cinematography, they just empathize cameras. Especially, like, now, it's not that bad. But it's just that if the action scenes were actually good, maybe it wouldn't be that bad of a quality. Like, and here, like, when it comes to Will Smith, now, here's the thing. I just feel bad for the poor guy, really. Apparently, people can shit on him all they want over the slap and because he's been not leaving Jada, but I just feel bad for this guy. I just feel bad for him. This guy had, like, people won't let go of something that was, like, 2 years ago. Yes, I get he should have handled Chris Rock's joke better, but at the same time, Jada's a piece of shit. He's a shit excuse of a wife that Will does need to leave, needs to break up with, because she's not a good person, she's a horrible wife, she cheated on his ass. Yeah. And, yeah. But yeah, and of course, like, this thing though, like, But yeah, but the thing is, though, the times is entertaining bits in this movie. They're just not memorable here anymore. His acting is just lifeless now, really, because then again, this was just clearly he's just there for because he needs a career, because he needs a movie thing for his career, because he's getting nothing else lately and needs a moneymaker. And since Bad Boys for Life made money, let's make a fourth Bad Boys movie. Martin here just overreacts. They make Marcus, who's supposed to be the smartest of the two, an actual dumbass that literally just obsesses over junk food and acts like a moron here. Like, yeah. Like, old Marcus did. Go in junk food frenzies. Get all upset because in a shootout, he gets a black jelly bean in his mouth. And even trying to sip punch in the same shootout. Fruit punch. Not a punch in the face. Fruit punch. I should have clarified that first. Clearly just trying to come off as a wannabe Deadpool. Yeah, then again, he like literally walks and grins like Ryan Reynolds' character in Free Guy when he wakes up at the end of his intro scene in Free Guy. Right there. So that does make sense. But yeah. Now back to more like the film, and after the whole junk food binging crazy thing, we then meet a DA officer named Jace McGrath, who's the villain of the movie. Meets a cartel banker, transfers funds to that account with Captain Howard's name, because it's a shitty plan, though. Then the process is done, and the banker's bodyguard is shot, and the banker's girlfriend has sold the gun to shoot the banker, and then herself, and then news breaks out that Howard was framed for involvement with cartels, which would make no sense whatsoever. So Mike and Marcus go to the station, they're confronting people that actually believe the stupid story, even though they're the only two that actually are smart not to fall for it. Then Judy comes in to get involved in the case, and because she knows that Mike's son killed Howard in the last movie, she'll kill him if she ever sees him, if she ever sees him. So Mike and Marcus then visit Mike's son in prison, and they find out Howard got targeted because his previous victims were eliminated, the work he had against the cartels, doesn't remember McGrath's name, and then remembers his face, and worked with him, and then of course worked with Isabella from the last movie, so they can identify him. So McGrath and his goons, they go to continue their work, trying to go into Howard's accounts, then trigger this failsafe, and then gets video messages sent to Mike and Marcus from Howard. He explains he knows if they're seeing this, like, he knows he's dead. That's the bit in the trailer. And I don't fall for that whatsoever. Again. And apparently knew he was going to be set up to take the fall for this, which should not really be a thing, apparently. Because this was just a plot device used to make the film. And they have to follow the Coke bottle giants and Fletcher. So they go to Fletcher's club to talk to him and that. They came on behalf of Howard, he knows that. And just as he's about to tell the two, though, Fletcher gets shot in the head by McGrath, and Marcus has the gun aimed at him to make him talk, so it's at first like, oh, I didn't shoot him this. Like, McGrath then just walks away, and they're going after Mike and Marcus. In the middle of the shootout, Mike then has the panic attack scene, and the gunmen get away, and then Rita shows up with the officers, and Mike doesn't let Marcus know that they're going to offer a tip from Howard, so yeah. Here's the thing, though. Like, the directing duo, they do try to provide some entertaining creative action scenes, but they're too over the top and too exaggerated here, and they just feel like they've been taken out of the other three movies because they can't think of anything else. It feels like you're just watching scenes from a superhero movie. Yeah. And some any realistic aspects just get lost. Mysterious aspects also get lost, and like, he learned that the main character, who's really behind the criminal cases, as soon as you meet the villains. The story's just a bit long-winded. The main characters just go around looking for answers that you would already know. And you have, like, more fun guessing, which their agents can or cannot be trusted. And it's already obvious from the start. Like, the story is long-winded. Like the main characters trying to commit many other side stories that are more separate from the main story. And it feels like you're watching moments from a different film or elements from the sequels because they ran out of ideas. Like when they, yeah. It feels like they can't think of an idea to do for their story because they don't have any other ideas anymore. So anyway, yeah, after they leave the crime scene, they take surveillance pics and footage to Kelly and Dorn. They help get the scan code unlocked. And there's another message from Howard. Apparently, we find out he was working a cartel case and he kept Mike and Marcus off of it because, like, Ruiz and Sanchez from the first movie, those two other detectives, they got put in it and they got killed. And then Howard warns the guys that the cartel apparently had people working with the police and FBI. So, wow. So, it's already a great idea. So, yeah, we get back to Mike's son, and he's attacked by thugs in prison that were sent by McGrath. So, Mike makes an argument to have Armando transported in a chopper, but McGrath and the Grooves hijack the chopper, and the pilot has to send a distress message, and that frames Mike and Marcus for the attack, and then McGrath slits his throat. Then McGrath escapes with his guys, and the chopper goes down. Mike and Marcus are fighting the guys on the chopper, and, like, and honestly, this is where it feels like Fast and Furious. Like, you, like in Bad Boys 2, you had them fighting on a subway train, and that was epic right there. Like, you had the subway train scene in Bad Boys 2 was more epic than them in a chopper. Yeah. They stop Armando from flying on the open hatchback, and then they free him, and Armando helps them make a crash landing in a lake. And then the crash site is surveyed by authorities, and the distress message gets received, and then so the three are now wanted fugitives. McGrath puts a bounty on their heads to every gangster in Miami. So then Mike and Marcus are following Mike's son with how to be on the run. And then, yeah, most of them, they're just going through the jungle, and Marcus has seen a good opportunity at a campfire for Mike to bond with his son. Neither are interested in connecting, but what's the point of this movie? What's the point of the end of this? Right there. Like, Armando finally redeemed himself after Mike finally got through to his head. And at the end credits scene, it seemed like Mike was going to help Armando redeem himself. What's the point of that then? If that wasn't, if they didn't want to reconnect in this movie at all. So what was the fucking point? Thanks for making that fucking pointless. So they get to a trailer park, and swipe closer to Rednecks, and they get that other bit in the trailer where they still can't get their lyrics right. Then they're discovered, they're held at gunpoint, but Armando hotwires the truck and gets them out of here. Yeah, literally after they crash land, a majority of them is in a jungle. And like, hell, once they got to the jungle, I was waiting for a song to accompany this moment, like, Two Worlds, We're Family, from Tarzan by Phil Collins, or Georgia, the jungle, strong as he can be, and George is doing his Tarzan yell, and then they're like, watch out for that tree, well, they're targeting or arguing, or hell, have the da 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 during the whole redneck chase scene, during the whole sequence. So they get back to Miami, and their truck breaks down, and so they have to contact Tabitha, Tiffany Haddish's character, who looks like a, dresses up like a prostitute. They meet at her club, they get guns, clothes, and a vehicle, then they're there. Tabitha is actually clearly not helping them, and sells them to their gangsters for the bounty, and as they're taken outside, some more rival gangsters, and of course, DJ Khaled's character from the third one comes back here. But of course, like, just before he gets revenge, though, Manny gets crushed by another car and gets hit with a Molotov cocktail and then burns. And some fire. So they just drive away. They shoot at the incoming gangsters. But Judy pursues, tries to fire Armando. And then they jump in the van. The engine catches fire and explodes. Like, they accidentally set their RV trailer on fire because Marcus is too much of an idiot. Not know how the stuff with a cocktail works. And yeah, DJ Khaled's annoying cameo is back in this one. Given no purpose, because as soon as he's about to have any action, he gets crashed by a car and set on fire and dies. So why does he come back? No reason. Yeah, like, once again, you can tell they just got lazy with the action sequences. Like here, this whole action scene, like, this whole gangster scene that just feels like, you just feel like you're watching a scene from John Wick 3 right here, or even more Fast and Furious right here. Like, yeah, you're watching scenes from both those. Now, it feels like you're just watching something for John Wick 2 or 3. And those are, I'd rather watch John Wick any day over this. Here's the thing, though. It's like they just need to have, they always need to have a shootout in every one of these fucking movies at this point. Yes, they're cop movies, but the shootouts in these were more fresh. And they were done better. Like, here, that's like they decided, okay, so they're back in town, but there's a bounty on their head, so we need another shootout. Let's just keep doing a shootout every few minutes because we're bad boys. No. Bad Boys is about the entertaining chemistry between Will and Martin, not a bunch of not a shootout in action every few minutes. And the style of the film is just similar. There's, like, whenever you try to have a good action scene, like, and you have the sound of guns here, then there's other action scenes where the camera's just shaking everywhere and you can't tell what's going on. Bad Boys for Life had some shaky cam, and even it wasn't done all over the place. Like, yeah. For the huge screen, there's effects that are unique, at least, like, There's some action bits I liked on the finale. I'll admit that. Okay? There's some... Yeah. But now, like... And just when I think they couldn't get more goofier and over the top, you get the finale right here, where after that whole chase, the three just make their way to Dorn's place. And apparently he has a secret relationship with Kelly. And even though the two are not happy about helping Armando, they're fine with helping Mike and Marcus go through evidence so that Armando can identify McGrath. And they manage to get somewhere after finding him on surveillance footage. And it digs up McGrath's history. Apparently, it turns out he and his team got taken hostage. And then gave them up after being tortured. So he's the only survivor. Then Mike tries to contact his wife about McGrath. But then the guys see through the security cameras in both their houses. McGrath sent guys to get Christine. So yeah, and Marcus's family too. So yeah, Mike tries to contact his wife, and Marcus gets in touch with Reggie. So, and they warn them both. But Reggie gets hit the family. And he hit him, and he grabs his gun, and he puts his shooting to good use. There, and then Christine gets visited by Callie, and then they get captured. And then McGrath contacts Mike and says he'll return them if he gives up Armando and all of Howard's evidence in their dumbass plan. And then, of course, Armando is fine with turning himself in. And yeah, like, right there. Like, right there, guys. Like, yeah, like, any of these, like, this is probably the one bit. The finale is, like, the one bit where any of this new team gets anything to do. They're not in the majority of the movie either. Like, You could take all the characters from Bad Boys for Life out of this movie, and you get nothing because they don't do shit. Like, so why would you need to bring any of them back for this? And like, when you find out Kelly's in a relationship with Dorn, Mike and Marcus are like, oh, no, well, we don't mind that. We don't mind that at all. Just to try to add a funny scene that wasn't even that funny. So yeah, Mike calls Rhea again, and apparently she's trying to tip off Lockwood. She then says she's going to go to the station, and he wants to go with her. They go to the elevator, and apparently Lockwood is working for McGrath, and Lockwood wants to kill her, but then Kelly and Dorn arrive. They take Lockwood down, and they get Lockwood to talk about and get up his motive from the cartels. They scan his voice. They have Mike set up a call posing as Lockwood to meet up with McGrath. And then Mike tells our other characters that they're the only ones that they can trust now because Mike and Marcus have the bounty on their heads. Because we need to imitate a John Wick movie now. Or John Wick has a bounty on his head for the past 3 sequels. So yeah, then our heroes go to meet the villains at a literal alligator park where they keep this albino gator named Duke. And then a plane brings McGrath out with our hostages. And then Mike has a shot at McGrath. But then apparently, when he's literally trying to shoot McGrath, he gets another panic attack. Is scared of hitting Christine. During one scene, a guy gets shot a million times, he falls off the dock. And the gator's in the water getting close to Armando's location. And that clues McGrath. You get the bit where Armando shoots that goon. He falls in the water. He gets chomped on by the gators. And then Mike, meanwhile, goes after McGrath and his wife that's being held hostage. And Lockwood makes an escape attempt. And there's another shootout again. Yeah. Our final fight is in a fucking alligator park. This movie, the finale was in an airport. And you had epic moments. The second one, this movie, was in Johnny's new mansion. And it went all the way to a Guantanamo Bay landmine. Where after Mike shot Johnny in the head, he fell in the landmine and his body blew up to pieces. Right there. And then, of course, this movie. In a Hidalgo Palace set on fire. This one, a literal dirty ass empty alligator zoo. Or an alligator farm. Yeah. A goon gets shot off several times by Armando, falls in the water, gets chomped on by two alligators, and during this, like, Mike literally jumps on a glass floor, lands like a superhero landing, doesn't even cut his knee or break his knee for some weird reason. The floor cracks a little bit, but he doesn't even break his knee, but shouldn't that have cut his knee or something? Apparently, seems immortal to that, just with the way he landed or almost breaking it. But then, of course, no, guess what? It finally breaks because Marcus is even more fucking stupid. He jumps after him and then it breaks. And that's where they counter Duke, the gator. And this part was so obvious. This part was obvious from the start. Marcus actually tries to calm Duke down as if he can whisper to gators now for some weird reason. When this gets this part, I already knew it would bite his idiot ass hand and not give a fuck. And it does that. Yeah, bites his hand. And then Marcus is almost out of any action most of the finale. You want to know what this bit reminds me of? This Duke Gator reminds me of fucking Lake Placid. Or hell, it reminded me of the fucking Looney Tunes back-to-action video game with the damn gators in the jungle levels. Like, whenever you end up landing Bugs or Daffy in the water during the jungle levels where there's gators in sight, the gators will chomp them, and then the box transports you to start over again. It felt like fucking that. Literally feels like a Looney Tunes back in action jungle level. They're thrown into now. Yeah. Because this movie fucking sucks gator ass! One of the biggest fucking insults to a franchise in a while. So yeah, then Lockwood is trying to hijack the plane, but Rita shoots it down, and the plane crashes into the building like a Fast and Furious movie again, because there's too much Fast and Furious action scenes in this. Then Lockwood shoots Dorn, tries to shoot Rita, and then kicks him into Duke's pit, and then literally goes to Lake Placid territory, where Lockwood becomes the dinner again. Like in a Lake Placid kill. And then Armando protects Callie from a Graf's goons. And then takes her to safety. Then Mike snaps out of his panic attack when Marcus is apparently able to slap Mike. And that's where we get the slap reference from the Oscars. Because I totally want to see real life references in a Bad Boys movie as well. Yeah, like, apparently, like, during this, he saw a vision of Captain Howard. Because apparently, he thought it was his fault that Howard got killed, even though there was no evidence of that in Bad Boys for Life at all. But Howard tells him to forgive himself. Like, there was no evidence that he blamed himself in this movie, so why should there be evidence in here? Mike never had that guilt. This just happened at a random moment. Right there. It was random. Like, how would he blame himself for something that just randomly came out of nowhere? Yeah, he was with Howard at the time he died, but yeah. Then Micah ends up at the beach he saw in his same beach he saw in his vision, because he can't really do much in the finale because he stupidly got his hand bitten. McGrath catches him, and Mike finds him. And McGrath makes him. Once again, there's another hostage situation here, like in Bad Boys 2 now. Let's take elements from the second movie. And it's to choose between Marcus or Christine. So yeah. Once again, we had a reference to the second movie when he shot Marcus in the ass. He shoots Marcus in the vest to get a shot at McGrath. And then he's pumped full of lead, and brains get blown out. And then, of course, Judy finds Armando and tries to shoot him. And then Kelly gets in the way, tells Judy he saved her life, and Judy's like, ah, fine, go. I wanted to kill him. So Mike helps Armando escape, and the authorities go to the crime scene, and McGrath's riding goons are arrested, and Howard has been exonerated, and yeah, that's it right there. Like, this Judy chick I forgot to mention most of, this chick just comes off, this came off as bitchy the whole film. She was not no Captain Howard, her actress was clearly just trying to be Joey Pantoliano, and she ain't any of that. I just hated her so damn much this movie. She wasn't even enjoyable like Captain Howard is. It's just like, and honestly, I hate her more than the generic villains in this whole movie. Nearly all the new characters here suck. The ones from the other films, like, they're just badly written here. But anyway, like, the movie's not over there because, like, Mike, Marcus, and the other, and Marcus's family, they're at the park at a barbecue, and they're arguing over who gets to cook the grill. Then Reggie breeds his chicken and asks if he can grill, but the bad boys laugh him off. And they remember that Reggie helped save Marcus's family, so they're like, okay, you can barbecue. And Reggie gives a satisfied smile. Yeah, it's like the one thing Reggie really does in this movie is kill a few bad guys. And then as a reward, he gets to basically grill. And yeah, then the movie's over. And before we go thinking, this may be the last one. No, it won't. Because judging by this opening weekend, Will Smith will want to make more, because this is all only career thing he's going to probably have for a while is this franchise. So if they do make a fifth one, are they just going to make it Bad Boys 1 or 2 again? Or if they do one, is Mike going to have a daughter whose friends get murdered by Fuchi as kids? Are they going to try to get revenge for their dad's death by literally maybe murdering one of their relatives or something? Or one of their relatives is of a danger and then Marcus is going to have to pretend to be Mike Laurie again? Or just maybe stop a Bitcoin robbery that leads them all the way to Siberia, and an action sequence is going to be them having to shoot a bunch of guys while skiing off a fucking mountain, or something like that, or skiing off a fucking mountain now, or like trying to push people off a fucking cliff. I can't imagine how more goofy and sillier they are going to get with this whole action whenever they try to make it. And guess what? It's never going to end, because in Hollyweird, there is no ending. You know what's sadder? This movie will make more money than Furiosa and the Fall Guy. I did see Furiosa, and I'll admit, while I do need to rewatch it to give it a more proper review and watch the other Mad Max movies first, that movie I thought was better, and I would rather see that instead of this disappointment any day. Hell, The Fall Guy sadly bombed, and that's a better movie than Bad Boys Ride or Die. Okay? Lisa Frankenstein was a funnier movie than Bad Boys Ride or Die. Right? Robin Williams' daughter did a better comedy than this movie was. Okay? Like, it's just sad. Now, if you liked this movie, each their own. My opinion, I think it sucks. Mike and Marcus, they do such dumb shit they would never do in the past three movies. And you don't even get the iconic From Now On line like the other three. Like, even the third one, it didn't really have that great of a From Now On line, but it still had the fucking line. And then, yeah, we still get the unfunny bit where Marcus keeps trying to do the, whenever they get the lyrics, after they say the what you're gonna do and come for you, Marcus keeping on doing the yeah, which wasn't even funny the last time. Would I have good qualities, though? Now, the one time it does feel like a Bad Boys movie is the opening scene, I guess. Up until Marcus pretty much opens and steals the Skittles and then tries to go up and pay for them. I do like some action bits in the finale until it got ruined by all the stupid gator deaths. And at least it wasn't too much of a sequel tease here this time, because that was a bad quality I had with 3, and it led to this movie being made. You did not need to make an extra scene after the actual ending. So yeah, Ride or Die, in my opinion, sucks. So in the end, please avoid this movie. Just go watch the first three movies instead of this, because those are more entertaining than this movie, and it's proof that this series is going to decline more and more as it progresses. Anyways, guys, that's it for my review of Bad Boys Ride or Die. If we're anything like to rank Bad Boys Ride or Die, here's how I'm going to rank this movie. So overall, if you really are a Bad Boys fan, I honestly would not believe any of the positive reviews I'm seeing right now and just skip this film and leave it at Bad Boys for Life, because there's nothing new here and it's just some stupid Fast and Furious shit now. And if you're wondering how I'm going to rank Bad Boys Ride or Die, I'm going to give Bad Boys Ride or Die a 4 out of 10. There we go, guys. That wraps up my rant for Bad Boys Ride or Die. And now, y'all know, you didn't see that if anybody gives me rude comments in the description, because, like, after what happened with Liv, sadly, last week, I decided I'm not going to put that in the description anymore. And from now on, I'm only going to block the people who call me insulting things in their comments. If it's not too rude, I'll leave it. But if it's a little overly, if it's overly rude, if it's people call me, if people are calling me things like a dumbass, then I will block them. Those all block. All right, just if it's tiny bit rude, I'll allow it. If it's overly rude, then I will block it. But anyway, guys, regardless, tell me in the comments below if you personally liked this movie or if you also didn't like it like I did. Each their own, regardless. Opinions are opinions. I just personally didn't like it, but if you like this movie, I'm happy for you. Just as long as you respect I didn't. Until then, guys, that'll be it for this rant. Thank y'all for watching. If you like this, want to see more, and don't forget to like, subscribe to Don G. Corleone.